Now, so I have a little talk I've prepared that I'm calling the auteur theory of design. And it starts with a question I have pondered for a long time. And really, the whole reason I kind of went into business for myself doing Daring Fireball is that I don't work well with other people. I really don't. I'm not a good employee, and I'm not a good manager. But the thing that I've observed, both through attempting to manage people and working for other people, is that I've noticed that a lot of times projects do not, the output of a project, the quality of it, is nowhere near the level of the aptitude of the talent that made it. You know, there's the old cliche, and I'm a very strong believer that if you're going to stand up and make a little argument, that if you cannot shoehorn it into a very trite cliche, it's not worth making at all. But the old cliche that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, there's also the other scenario, and I think it's often more common, where the whole is a lot less than the sum of its parts in a collaborative endeavor. Why does that happen? And I think, especially in a scenario like this, that the tech people, we can all imagine, let's say, like a hypothetical company. Let's just say, because we're here, it's Macworld, we'll say like a software company. And they're big, and they've been around for a long time, and they make a lot of money. And they have a reputation that it's really, really hard to get an engineering job there, that they hire very good programmers who are very bright, and the interview process is very difficult. They ask you all these trick questions, and they make you get up on a whiteboard and write hashing algorithms off the top of your head. I mean, you could, you know, in theory, just theoretically, they could be headquartered in a place like Redmond, Washington. And they have these really bright engineers, and everybody around the world knows that they hire really good engineers, and they hire good user experience people. And they, you know, like 25,000 people, and they make these teams, and the teams go away, and they work for 18 months, and it turns into 36 months, and then they come out with a product, and then inevitably, you know, it's crap. So I think that filmmaking as an art form can serve as a useful archetype for talking about creative collaboration in general. And the reason I think that is that even just as lay people, as people who just watch movies, go to the movies, you know, you get your Netflix in the mail, it's very easy to just get the gist of just how varied the components, the various parts of this widely varying creative thing are, that there's a writer who sits around and is very lonely and writes the screenplay. And everybody knows what writing is. And then there's actors, you know, who bring the characters to life, and set designers who create, you know, this is where we're going to do it. And there's a cinematographer who runs the camera and oversees the lighting. And then there are sound people. And there's a composer who writes original music from the ground up specifically to fit the tone and to strike emotional chords for the particular story they're typing that's trying to tell. There's all these people. I mean, if you ever watch the credits at the end of a movie nowadays, it's literally like 15 minutes, like at the end of Lord of the Rings. It's like 20 minutes of credits. But at the center of it all is somebody who's called the director. And there's exceptions, you know, of directors who also write their movies and directors who also are the editor of the movie. But for the most part, the director doesn't actually do any of those specific things. They don't act, they don't run the camera, they didn't write the screenplay. In France, there was this thing called New Wave, the French New Wave of film criticism. And very fancy stuff, and you know, like most stuff that comes out of France. But the gist of their argument was this argument that the director of a movie is, or at least should be and can be, and in the case of almost all great films is more than just a manager of artists. That the director truly is an artist themselves, and that they, while a writer produces words and an actor uses words and action, you know, and the cinematographer has a camera to actually use, that the director is, his tools are these various components and that you conduct them into a certain way. And what you're really doing, you're not flipping switches on the camera, you're not making choices as an actor as to how to do a line reading, but what the director is doing nonstop from the beginning of signing on until the movie is done is making decisions. And that just simply making decisions one after another can be a form of art. And what's really neat about our language, English, is that we're absolutely shameless about going into any other language we need and just stealing one of their words and then taking it over here and just making up a new definition for it that isn't really quite the same. In French, auteur, this auteur theory of filmmaking, auteur is just the French word for author. But we've taken it and we've added auteur to our language, even though we already have author. If you look it up in the dictionary, the first definition is, this is Merriam-Webster, I'll give credit, a film director whose practice accords with the auteur theory. Now, don't you hate definitions like that where you look up auteur and then they use the word? I mean, that's cheating. I'm not even sure how that qualifies as a definition when you do that. But I like this one. I like number two. An artist as a musician or writer whose style and practice are distinctive. And I'd like to expand that if I could. I would expand that parentheses, and I would say an artist is almost the director of any creative collaborative project whose style and practice are distinctive. So Alfred Hitchcock, I'll take a step back and say that the you hear French New Wave film criticism and the auteur theory, and if you haven't ever heard this stuff before, you're probably thinking it's a lot of highfalutin crippity crap. You know, like movies with grown men dressed up in bunny suits talking about nihilism, you know, and the whole thing is filmed with a camera that's sideways. But it's not. I mean, they were great appreciators of mainstream popular cinema, and perhaps the single greatest hero of the French New Wave was Alfred Hitchcock. You know, who by the 50s was well established, you know, maker of very popular films, but who in America was not really seen as a great filmmaker, at least by the critical establishment, but was seen as, well, he just makes those movies that, you know, people like to go see. But the French really saw that he had done something grand, which is that he'd built up this massive body of work within the confines of this studio system, where every single one of his movies is absolutely and without question definitively Hitchcockian. And that's the point I'm trying to make, is that by making these decisions at the central hub, without him actually moving the camera or whatever, he can impart it's as distinctive as handwriting on the flavor of his films. But when you make decisions, there's ostensible authority and real authority. And what I mean by that is that whether you have authority in name only or whether you can really, really make the decisions. And the test of that is whether you can get away with doing something that is absolutely crazy. Like, what if you go nuts? What if you flip your lid and you say, this is how we're gonna do it, and it's nuts, and everybody else thinks it's nuts? Does it still go out that way? Then you have real authority. And maybe you're not nuts. Maybe it's just that your taste is better than everybody else's and they just can't perceive it. But that's the test. And I would hold up as an example of that the television show The Sopranos. How many people here are familiar with The Sopranos? It's a show about, I think they were Italians. And it ran on HBO for 6 years. There were 86 episodes. And it was really... my friend Jason Kotke linked to it a couple of weeks ago, but it was this great essay from 1999 in The New Yorker by Vincent Canby after the first season of The Sopranos, where he sort of wrote this appreciation of it after the first 13 episodes and said, it doesn't really feel or seem anything like episodic dramatic television at all. It feels more like a mega movie, like this man David Chase, who is the auteur of The Sopranos, the creator, he wrote, he directed. That it was best served watching it like a TV critic does, all at once, just watching one episode after another, because it really comes across as a mega movie. So after 80-some episodes of this, and effectively creating an 80-hour movie with millions of fans and tremendous critical acclaim, that rare sort of combination of where you've got critics saying this might be the best TV show ever, and you've got millions and millions of people who say this might be my favorite TV show ever. It all built up to the final episode, and I'm not going to describe it because to describe it would ruin it for the one or two people who maybe have not seen it. But let's just say if you have seen it, you know that it was like a slap in the face. I mean, it was. I wanted to get up, and I really wanted to kill the man because it was just unsatisfying. And it's not so much like whether it was happy or sad, but that it was just an incredibly odd choice. And he could do it because he had real authority. And in the movie industry, they call that final cut. And it's sort of a very meaningful word that Apple used to pick for their film editing software, because eventually, somewhere in every endeavor, somebody gets to say, this is good enough, it goes out the door. That's final cut. And in the movie industry, it's very, very rare for a director to actually have final cut. While ostensibly they get to decide this is how the movie will look and this is what's going to be ready, and then it goes into the studios, and you know, the studio guys, the jerks, you know, they diddle with the movies. And every once in a while you can see the results of this. You see something like, how many people have heard of a movie called Blade Runner? It's probably, you know, probably like one of your favorite movies if you're, you know, here at Macworld listening to me give a talk. But the original theatrical release was taken away from the director by truly, you know, despicable evil men at this movie theater or movie studio, and they ruined it. They took a beautiful movie, well cast, well edited, beautiful with great source material, and then they butchered it. And what's neat is you can then see that, because years later Ridley Scott, the director, got to come back and he got to ship his actual original version, what he intended, and it could not be more different. That having this final authority of being able to say this is how it should be is important. Alfred Hitchcock never had final cut because he worked in the studio system. He worked before even the most established directors could get it. And he came up with a very clever hack to effectively give himself final cut. There was nothing in his contract that said that he had final authority of how his films would be delivered, but what he did was he meticulously planned out the film in advance of ever having anybody on stage or turning on a camera, and storyboarded his movies, practically invented the art form of storyboarding, of doing like a comic book version of the movie. And then when he actually did shoot the movie, he shot only enough footage that even if they completely took the movie away from him after it was finished, it could only be put together in one way that would actually make any sense, which was the way that he exactly wanted. And if you read any biographies of him, it infuriated the producers he worked for, because he worked at a time when it was a standard practice for directors to shoot lots of extra angles, lots of extra footage, and always shoot multiple endings, and then you let the studio jerks decide, well, here's how it's going to go to the public. So all of this elaborate parenthetical is really, it's leading up to the actual thesis of this talk, which is this. It's this idea I have. It's an answer to my question of why the output often doesn't equal the talent that produced it. And it's this, that the quality of any collaborative creative endeavor tends to approach the level of taste of whoever is in charge. And in the parlance of this framework of saying, let's just pretend that movie making applies to any such endeavor at all, we could define in charge as whoever has final cut. Whether you're working on a website, whether you're working at a consumer electronics company to make a new cell phone, whether you're, you know, making a Mac app, an iPhone app, any sort of creative thing, there's somebody who says this is good enough. And whatever their level of taste is, that's what the quality of the product tends to approach. And I worry that this whole thing sounds terribly, terribly obvious, but to me the insight, the thing that kind of clicked the light on my head and made sense of it all, was that it works in both directions. And what you really want is you want somebody leading the project whose taste is up here, and you've got talent that is here, and through the course of making the thing, the people, the goal and the leadership, it gets closer and closer to this taste. But it does work in the other direction too, where if whoever has the final authority, even if they're uninvolved day to day, they're just somebody who at the very end, you run it through and they're like, ah, now you gotta add some buttons, you gotta put a happy ending, you gotta put a voiceover on it. If their taste is down here, it doesn't matter how good the talent is. It's inevitably gonna lead the output to kind of reach that lower level of quality. And so I give you this as a takeaway, what I hope you get out of this talk, is that Alfred Hitchcock wasn't a jerk. He didn't do this thing where he shot a movie in a way that can only be put together one way, even though it was against all of the rules and all of their expectations. He didn't do it to be a jerk. He did it because he knew that he was right. He knew that what he was giving them was a better film than what they would send out if he did what they wanted him to do. And so you may know that you're right, and you may know that it's your taste that's up here. And you know, we always say, well, it's a matter of opinion, and no, nobody's opinion is right or wrong. But you know what, that's not true. Sometimes you know that your opinion is right, and you can't explain it, you just know. I mean, sometimes you think you're right, sometimes you know you're right. When you know you're right, you're probably still not gonna get final cut by asking for it, but you might get it by just taking it. Thank you.